Welcome to The Culture Edit, unique perspectives into the personal and professional lives of individuals at the helm of successful business, athletics, art, and design.
Welcome to The Culture Edit.
Episode 40, the big 4-0.
Threw you off with that one.
By opening before I could open?
Yeah, I've never opened before. We learned something special about ourselves yesterday.
We cannot record a podcast after doing a 5-hour ride in the cold because we are literally too exhausted and it just doesn't work.
We were exhausted and we waited too late.
Yeah.
And we realized that that's not a good format for recording a podcast. So we won't do that again. It's Monday.
Today's Monday and we are recording the re-recording the podcast that I've already edited, but I just thought it sounded too terrible to do. And this is how dedicated we are. It is 7 o'clock at night. On Monday.
This is the first time we've ever done that.
Yeah, I mean, we just sounded really tired.
Yeah.
Like, it was, we didn't sound good.
We didn't sound like ourselves.
Yeah, so, and this is a fun one. So, I'm making us redo it because I want it to be fun like we had intended. But not a big deal. I'll just be up through the night editing. So, you're welcome, everyone.
Thank you, listeners.
I think we are going to change the publishing date, the weekly publishing date, to Tuesday, though, because as we're getting more into the throes of the year and client projects and work and quite frankly, riding through the winter, it wasn't as hard. But now that we have the weekday group rides, it's just become a lot more difficult to try and record and then edit on the weekends and get it all published on by Monday.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
So Tuesdays it is.
Yep. Tuesdays it is.
And we've actually done that the last few weeks.
Yeah. Maybe one day we'll be able to not work so much so then I can actually edit during the week. But the reason we were so exhausted on Sunday was because we had our very first Speed Club Sunday, which is, for those of you that don't know, we host a group ride through the winter called Speed Club Saturdays. And it's really fun. It's a small to mid-sized group. We usually do 70 to 100 miles at a winter pace. And we've had such a good turnout that we figured, why stop it? Let's create a special calendar, but move it to Sundays because, as Atlanta cyclists know, there's a ride called Tucker.
Webbridge.
In Webbridge, and they're both fast and really like prepare you for the race season. So I know a lot of people like to do that. So we didn't want to interfere with Tucker. But we decided Speed Club Sundays made sense. So again, it's
just select Sundays and it's always a unique and special route that we'll do.
And there'll be sometimes we drive to the mountains, sometimes we drive south, but it's, you know, the goal is to have fun.
And yesterday was the first time we've hosted a ride out of the new studio.
And came back to the new studio.
A lot of new riders and new friends that we met for the first time, which was really cool. And they were friends of the pod and subscribers to our newsletters. Make sure you subscribe to our newsletter so you can get all this information. But it was really cool.
Yeah, we had a lot of fun. It went down to Serenbe. For those of you that don't know what Serenbe is, because even a lot of people in Atlanta have never been.
It's Westworld.
Yes, so Serenbe is the Westworld of Atlanta.
if you watch that show.
Yeah, it's a perfectly curated community. It's really beautiful. There's a farmhouse, there's a farm, there's restaurants. It's growing like crazy.
If you subscribe to our other newsletter, there's actually an article from the New York Times. Yeah, New York Times about Yollywood. And Norman Reedus selling his house. It's in this neighborhood.
Yeah, like the new money place to live.
A lot of Hollywood people live there because it's so close to Trilith, the studio.
Yeah, Trilith and the airport. It's far enough away from the city that people leave you alone. So you can actually walk through the community without being, you know, harassed.
Yeah.
But it's really cool. So we rode there, did a cafe stop at the general store, hung out. And then rode back, but we're just really, really tired. One thing we did discover is that we need something to fill time at the before the ride when everyone meets at the studio. And we're not ready to invest in a full like espresso machine.
No.
Because we just don't have time. I'm not going to stand in the kitchen making
espressos. And neither one of us care that much about espressos.
Yeah, that's the thing is neither of us are like big coffee connoisseurs, so even though we enjoy coffee, it's just anyways. So we came up with the idea based on our experience in Miami, which is we can make Cuban coffee, where you make the really, really good Cuban coffee in like the pot, And then you pour it, you mix the sugar and make the like foam, and then you pour it into the little mini cups. And so
little paper cups.
Yeah, little paper cups. So you pass that out to everyone. So it's like a little shot of a really strong espresso and sugar right before you take off. And I think that'll serve the place of where we were meeting at coffee shops before, and everyone had something to do. Now we can do that.
Yeah, I can't wait for that.
Yeah, very excited. Do you want to talk about classic season?
Yesterday was Gent Wevelgem. Former guest of the pod, Luke Limperti, is participating in the classic. So if you're interested in that, to me, it's by far the most fun cycling part of the season. Most fun race part of the season, mm-hmm. in terms of watching races, because they're crazy. And our favorite race, Tour of Flanders, is this coming Sunday. Mm-hmm. Hard to believe it's been a year since we were there.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Shout out to Yuri. It's going to be really exciting for the next basically 5 to 6 weeks of watching monuments every weekend.
How can people that aren't cycling connoisseurs watch a lot of these one day classics races?
Yeah, I was talking about that. I think it was to Bryant, who's pretty new to cycling, and I was asking him if he's following and he was trying to figure out how to watch cycling. So right now, there's basically three platforms that have cycling, mm-hmm. The three big ones. The biggest is Max, believe it or not. Mm-hmm. So if you have HBO Max, you now have probably 80% of the races. And you have to go up to the top where it says BR Sports, so Bleacher Report Sports. It may be an add-on for some. It's not for us for whatever reason, for whatever our plan is. So that's where a majority of them are. But then you've got yesterday's race was on Flow Sports, much smaller platform. They've got a lot of obscure races. If you get those two, you get most of everything except for the Tour de France and Paris-Roubaix, which is on Peacock.
Okay. So I think that a lot of people think they can only watch the Tour de France. I think it's what people know about if you're not a cyclist. But I would encourage you to, you know, dip your toe into the spring classics.
Yeah.
They're all one day races. So there's not a lot of investment into having to follow what's happening.
Yeah.
And really you can just fast forward to like the last 20K and get all the action. So it's, you know, it's just fun to watch the sprints at the end, and there's crashes and it's kind of chaotic.
Yeah. That's a good point. It's not as complicated as a grand tour, like the Tour de France. It's just straightforward. There's a start line and there's a finish line.
Yeah.
And there's no timing involved. Just whoever finishes that finish line first
wins.
Yeah,
the simplest form.
His name is usually going to be Matthew Vanderpool or Wout Van Aert, but maybe like yesterday's race, someone else will surprise you.
Yeah. Speaking of, one day classics and people doing really well and exciting things, our very own Michael Garrison Racing has been winning every race that he goes to. So far, we're in the early stages of the race calendar. It's going to get harder.
They're called tune-up races.
Tune-up races. We are in that, so we don't want to get ahead of ourselves, but we are very proud of him for how well he's been doing so far.
Yeah, he's won two local gravel events, and then he flew out to Austin for the Pace Bend weekend, which is a pretty big, I think, for that area, mm-hmm. Regional road race that he won overall and several races in it. So what's coming up, though, is going to be real fun. We've got Sonny King Criterium, which is one of the biggest criteriums in the country. He's racing on the 13th, mm-hmm. And then turn around flying to Sea Otter to race mountain bikes.
And road. We'll
be there all on the same weekend. And so we're going to Sea Otter for the first time ever. If you're going to be in Sea Otter, let us know.
Yeah, let us know. Say hi.
Yeah.
Want to hang out?
So we're going early to California. We're going to have some meetings.
In San Diego.
And then we're going to make our way up to Sea Otter, which is in the...
which is pretty far. It's going to be a long road trip.
Monterey? Is that where it is?
Monterey, I think.
Yeah, so I think maybe we might stop halfway, or maybe we'll do a night in LA if we can find some reason. Maybe there's some folks we can meet with while we're in LA. And if not...
I mean, that doesn't get us that far.
Yeah, it's like 2 hours.
But it's,
I just want to go to LA.
I was thinking we could stop in Santa Barbara.
Okay. That's what we did last time we did this.
Yeah, that's halfway.
Yeah.
Anyway, so.
You like Santa Barbara?
Yeah, I did.
Especially Gibraltar.
Oh, yeah, loved it. Not doing that climb again.
Okay.
So we have a fun trip planned, and then coming back here, and Michael has Speed Week. He has all the big crits coming up. specifically Athens Twilight, which will be a fun time. We have some things planned for that. And it's going to be a good year.
Okay, enough bike talk. Let's get to the good stuff, our new favorite restaurant. We previewed last time.
Yeah, we went to the friends and family opening weekend.
We've been back. So we've been there twice. Pendolino, which is a new restaurant in Buckhead, and it is the restaurant of our good friend, celebrity chef Kevin Maxey. Yeah, we are very excited about this new spot, even though it's kind of far for us.
But it works out because if we do like meetings up in Buckhead, we can just hop over there, grab a bite to eat, and wait for traffic to die down.
Yeah.
But like really impressed with the interior design, the way they built everything out. I think they have a patio, so once it warms up, that'll be really nice. It's Italian. It's kind of like a family fare type of Italian food. Nothing confusing, nothing overwhelming, just really, really, really good recipes and really good food.
Everything's handmade.
We tried...
Like the pasta's handmade.
Yeah, we've tried a lot of things on the menu because, again, we went to the family and friends like opening and they let us taste a lot of things. But I think our favorite menu item is the meatballs.
Meatballs. Isn't that crazy to say that?
Yeah. It sounds basic.
Like we're not even meatball people.
No, we're not ground meat people.
Yeah.
But it's phenomenal. And then it comes with this like special pasta that I can't pronounce and I've never had before, but it's really, really good.
It's like a long flat noodle with like ridges.
Yeah.
But it was like long. Really long.
Yeah, it was good.
It's his signature dish as well, because I went back to the kitchen. I can go in the kitchen now. That guy just walked in the kitchen.
Yeah, you're that guy.
He said it's his signature dish that he's been cooking for 20+ years.
And I said, like, imagine if your dad came home and he just, like, whipped up these meatballs and spaghetti and it's just, like, the best thing you've ever tasted. Yeah. How as a kid you'd be so, like, you would take it for granted that, like, if your spouse didn't, I don't even know how you keep up. How do you even keep up with a dad that is that great of a chef? So, anyways.
I think you probably just take it for granted.
Maybe. Yeah. And then you appreciate it later in life when you're older. But we'll go through the list. You know, another thing that was unique that we liked, which doesn't sound like it's unique, but they have these olives that it's like a citrus olives, marinated olives, but they bake it in the oven.
They're like warmed.
Yeah. So the olives are warm, which sounds so simple, but it's really nice. And then we tried the egg.
It's an appetizer, by the way. You're going to look at me like, why would I buy olives? But it's really worth it.
And it has like cheese in it. But eggplant marinara, amazing if you love eggplant. The barbecue octopus, that was your favorite, right?
By far my favorite. He does this crazy thing where he puts pepperoni in with the octopus and the celery and then also the potatoes.
Yeah, it was like a mashed potato on the bottom, which this all sounds like it doesn't belong together, but it belongs together.
Awesome, and like so tender. You know I'm an octopus connoisseur, and so I've evaluate octopus everywhere I go, all based on my experience with the best octopus you can possibly eat is in Portugal, because it's incredibly tender.
Mm-hmm.
And rarely do you find that in the U.S. where the octopus is, and I guess it's how they prepare it. But Kevin's was that tender. I was in Portugal.
Another place that has good octopus is Saint Cecilia, because that you've said that before.
That's right.
And that's also one of Kevin Maxey's restaurants that he used to run and be the chef for. So
all right, we're gonna talk to him. We're gonna get him to come on the podcast so we can talk about octopi preparation.
Exactly. We also had the prosciutto pizza, which was phenomenal. We had the snapper crudo, which I really, really liked. It was, just super fresh and good. The burrata was unique because it came with charred carrots instead of like the standard tomato burrata balsamic type situation.
Sounds weird, but it was really good.
Really good. And some sort of pesto, I think it was it was a pesto.
But it was like purple carrots.
Yeah. Or it was mixed.
Then
I really liked the Caesar because I am a Caesar salad connoisseur. Lightly dressed to perfection. The croutons were amazing, homemade. And then you also liked the shrimp scampi.
Yeah, shrimp scampi. The noodles were perfectly al dente. I didn't even have to ask them to be al dente. We had high expectations. We've literally talked to Kevin about this restaurant for 5 years. We've been talking him into it, so we were a little nervous because he, listened to our advice.
Totally.
So we're a little nervous about it, but so glad he did it because it's very awesome. And I do want to, because I know he's listening to this, I do just want to point out that I only asked for one menu item, and that's cacio e pepe, and he didn't add it.
I feel like it's just like the basic dish of like
Rome.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah.
It
it's
is
too,
good,
you're
though.
Saying it's too basic.
I think it's too basic, yeah.
Okay.
Maybe, I don't know, because it's not like it's expensive. So we'll press them on that on the next podcast.
They actually said they could make it. Remember, they did say they're like, if you really want it, we'll make it.
Yeah.
Or we'll see if Chef will make it.
And he didn't.
Yeah, that's true. And I said ask him, and they didn't. They just brought me something.
Oh, we almost forgot. So our friend of the pod, Ryan, him and his wife Natalie went with us to the opening night as well. And his favorite dish was the chicken parm. And Ryan
crushed
is
it.
Yeah, and really, I mean, we all split. It's a massive dish of chicken parm. Like it we didn't even, I don't even know if we finished it amongst
we didn't.
The four of us.
We couldn't.
Yeah. But really good.
They are gonna make a smaller portion, so you better get in there sooner than later if you want a giant portion of chicken parm.
Yeah.
But super, again, I don't know how he makes it so tender, but it was like super tender.
Yeah, everything was top notch.
Yeah.
And that's pretty much it. I don't want to go too deep into our review because, again, we want to have him on the pod and ask him more questions. But definitely book a reservation or just go sit at the bar early and have a nice meal. It's a good vibe.
For sure. Especially if you're in Buckhead and you're looking for a new restaurant. And it's going to feel a lot different than the other options that are there.
For sure.
It's like North Buckhead, I would guess.
Yeah, it's
Chastain Park.
It's off of Roswell Road, so it's like between Chastain Park and Sandy Springs.
Yeah.
So I know another thing that you want to touch on while we're talking about restaurants is we went to Breaker Breaker on Saturday.
Which we've talked about Breaker Breaker on the podcast before, but we went there Saturday and we're blown away once again.
Yeah, I mean, it was a beautiful day. The Beltline, I mean, we're at that time of the year where our neighborhood becomes Disney World and it's a little bit difficult to get into places.
Yeah.
Especially when we don't really want to make reservations, but we walked into Breaker Breaker, got a seat at the bar, ordered food, and it was, it's some of the freshest seafood. I mean, I had the peel neat shrimp, which were really good. Caesar, you had a blackened grouper sandwich, which is like one of your favorite.
Yeah.
And that led us to thinking about, okay, so all these new patios that are on the Beltline.
It's patio season in Inman Park on the Beltline.
Exactly.
And again, the Beltline is a sidewalk.
It's like
tourist
the high,
attraction.
It's like the High Line in New York, except even crazier because even on the High Line, there's no like restaurants right off. Oh. I mean, there's like some below the High Line.
Yeah, and you don't have like thousands of people walking in front of you the whole time.
And there's a lot more. There's a lot more rules on the High Line.
Rules.
Rules. There's no rule. The Beltline, the Atlanta Beltline, is a lawless place.
That's
like,
true.
Rules rules already don't apply in Atlanta, but they really don't apply on the Beltline. So you got people driving motorcycles down the Beltline. You have
That's true.
I mean, it's chaos. Complete chaos.
Yeah, like full on motorcycle.
Yeah. But we're gonna go through and name some of our favorite patios to enjoy if you do want to come down to the Beltline.
And you're gonna rate them?
Yeah, I think we'll rate them. Yeah.
Okay. Are we rating them like Dave Portnoy pizza style rating?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, so first one, let's just do Breaker Breaker since we're there.
Breaker Breaker.
And there were probably, I would guess, 200 people on that patio.
Oh my gosh,
when we were there.
Yeah, it was crazy. So Breaker Breaker, I give it a 8.5.
Wow, it's high.
Yeah, a high score.
Very high.
Food's really good. We've been there multiple times with a lot of different friends. Everyone always loves it. So it's kind of like a crowd pleaser. The drinks are medium. The drinks are okay. They only have canned wine or boxed wine, which I'm not a huge fan of. The margaritas are good, although we did have one kind of one-off margarita.
Not
that
consistent.
Wasn't great. Not necessarily consistent. But if you're like a beer person, easy. Like tons of beer, whatever. And the food, in the atmosphere is a party. It's definitely a party. It's not a place I would take like your kids. But if you're, you know, just...
But if you have Belgian parents coming into Atlanta from out of town, this is where you take them.
Yeah, yeah. We did take Goose's parents there. They were... I mean, you immerse yourself into the American experience of that place.
For sure.
Because it's based off of the being, like, from the panhandle of Florida, like, on the Gulf.
Right, where I'm from.
And so it looks like a truck stop in... It's in...
Containers.
Containers.
Yeah.
So it's just a totally different, and it's literally in the middle of the Beltline. So it's like container restaurant in the middle of the Beltline, and it's really cool.
Not
so
fancy.
Not fancy at all. Very fun. All
right. Well, then let's go to the other end of the Inman Park section of the Beltline.
Okay.
Which that's in Reynolds Town. That's not even in my park. Let's go to Freedy.
So personally, I love Freedy. I give it a...
We know.
I give
they have a new patio. That's why I'm asking this.
I give it an 8.6.
Ooh, above Breaker Breaker.
Slightly above Breaker Breaker because they have a really good... Because they're wine. They have a better wine.
They do.
Yep. And it's not as much of a party. Definitely not as much of a party.
No.
But I know I enjoy the more chill patio scene more than the crazy patio scene. So for me...
It's more like European experience.
Yeah, it's more European.
Yeah.
So I really like that. And yeah, you can just get like an Aperol Spritz, some wine, and...
It's owned by Italian, so that makes sense.
Yeah, I enjoy it. So I give... I always... It's kind of my place that I will just always go back to because it's reliable.
Would you say 8.6?
Yeah.
And Breaker Breaker was 8.5?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Pretty close.
Mm-hmm.
Across the street, Pure Talk.
Well, I mean, that's where we met.
Yeah, that's what I'm wondering.
I'm not going to take that into account because that will, you know, make the score just off the charts. But
they've done a lot of work there to get their food up.
They've done a lot of work. They definitely lost us for a few years because their food quality kind of went down, but it's back. Maybe a 7.8.
Okay.
Because I think the patio, solid. It's really fun. Like you can watch sports there. So it has kind of that sports bar, but Mexican food. You know, there's a fun, it's fun.
Okay. What about across the street at Bar Taco?
So Bar Taco, I give it a 7.3.
Less than Pure. I think the atmosphere and the vibe at Bar Taco is better. And their margaritas are my favorite.
Yeah, their margs are better. Well, it depends
on... And their former client.
Yeah, their margs are more of like a skinny margarita just by nature. So we do like those. I think the atmosphere changes so much there that like...
Yeah.
That's what's unpredictable because sometimes it's really, really fun and sometimes it just feels really chaotic and there's like no servers anywhere. You can't order anything. So it's the unpredictability is a little weird.
They do the weird thing where you just order on the app.
Yeah.
So that I think that's where they lost you is when we just no longer had servers.
Yeah.
So you order on the app, you submit your ticket, you pay. And then someone randomly just brings you the food.
Well, but also the past three times, and I am counting, the past three times we've been there, they have completely gotten our order wrong.
Yeah.
And we waited for an hour and no food ever came out. Like, even though one thing would come out and then we keep waiting. And so it's been a pretty bad experience the past three times we've been there.
Yeah. And this was a time where, this is a place where it was our favorite.
It used to be our,
number one.
But
number one go-to.
After Elisa left.
The manager.
The manager. It just has consistently gone downhill.
Manager is everything.
Really is. Apre diem. Apre diem. Mm. I mean, I give Apre diem.
This is gonna be interesting.
9.1 out of 10.
Wow.
Because
seriously.
Well, think about
better than everything.
Think about the number one place I always ask to go in the summer. It's always
Freedy.
Freedy and Apre diem. But the reason I give Apre diem, maybe I shouldn't give them a high. I know because their food is better than Freedy.
Yeah.
Their food's better than Freedy. So. I mean, it's completely different, but Apre diem still has that European style and they have a really big patio. Like, I don't think we've ever even eaten inside.
No.
But there's no tourists because it is off the Beltline, but you can't see it from the Beltline. So
it's hidden.
It's hidden. If you don't know it's there, you wouldn't even know.
Locals only.
And it's like, it doesn't even show up on Google when you search.
No.
It's perfect. Maybe that's by design. So
it's like a secret membership club for the neighborhood.
Yeah. Yeah.
So by accident.
Yeah, so I love, and also it's affordable. It's much more affordable than the rest of the restaurants.
I don't think they've ever changed their prices. They've been open for 15, 20 years.
Yeah. So that is one of my favorite places, also because it's very dog friendly.
Yeah.
So it's easy to take the dogs there. So.
What about BrewDog?
6.5.
Just on the food versus the vibe.
Yeah.
It's just beer.
It's like they're just kind of missing.
It's a chain.
The vibe... I don't really understand why they haven't been able to get the vibe right because the food is not bad. Like we've had I would just say it's okay bar food. It's not anything amazing. The pretzel is really good. That's the one thing I will say. The pretzel. If you're like a huge beer person, I'm sure you love it because that's what it's based on.
I think that's what it is that we're not beer people and everyone that's flocking there is like obsessed with beer.
Yeah.
So I think if you're not in that
world,
that beer brewery world, that you don't, it's like,
no. Yeah, I mean,
and it's a chain. I think the chain vibe always throws us off, just like McCray's that just opened across. It's the same thing. It's like a chain. It's solid, but it's not like you're gonna go all your way to go there.
I mean, if you love fried food, these are all places to go. But like, for me, we don't gravitate towards like fried food all the time. I mean, if we were going to do fried food, I would just go to the Albert because...
That's true.
You know, that's kind
their,
of...
Their patio is just a parking lot.
It's just a parking lot. But again, not a lot of tourists. And yeah, so...
Parking lot with plastic chairs.
The funny thing about the Albert is there's not a lot of tourists, and I think it's because the bartenders are so mean.
Yeah, like, that's
true. They're not mean to you if they recognize you, but if you appear to be a confused tourist, they're just not helpful.
Yeah.
Which... It's fine. Keeps. We've got to have some places that are we have for ourselves.
Yeah, exactly. I've got one more. Do you know what I want to ask you?
Club Kroger.
Oh, well, okay. I got two more. Club Kroger. There you go.
I can't even remember what I've given everything now. So like 7.5.
Okay, that's solid.
I like Club Kroger again because, so Kroger, for those of you in Europe or in other parts of America that don't have Kroger, it's just a grocery store.
Right.
And
but this one's special because they serve alcohol out of a window.
Yeah, this one's on the Beltline, and they have a giant patio on the Beltline, and there's a bar, a full bar inside Kroger, and then there's a walk-up window where you can buy wine and beer outside. And so, yeah, you just walk up, order a rosé. It's like, I think happy hour is like $5, and regularly it's like $8 a glass, so a lot cheaper than anywhere else. And then you just sit down and you have this really good view of all of the chaos of the Beltline.
Yeah.
So it's kind of
good. It's great people watching.
It is. And it's fun like after a bike ride because obviously it's very casual. So you can just roll your bike up onto Kroger, get a glass of rosé and sit there with your friends and just like have fun. It kind of feels like what you would do in high school if you were allowed to drink in high school.
That's true.
You know?
Last one, the reason I would say we have so many tourists in MN Park on the Beltline goes to one entity, and that is Lady Bird.
Yeah.
Lady Bird is by far the most popular. It is slammed every weekend. Not during the week, just during the weekend. I know it's a loaded question for you. I'll just go ahead and tell the viewers, the listeners, I refuse to go there based on several principles, but what's your rating of them?
So when they first opened, my rating would be a 3.2. why does that make you laugh? Because I said it with such confidence.
Well, that and it's just so much lower than everyone else.
Yeah. But, yeah. Well, I mean, I really don't like it.
Yeah.
When they first opened, we were pretty excited because it was like it's a massive mulched patio, like campfire kind of like it's like a camping kind of vibe.
Yeah.
So there's like they used to have bonfires. I don't really think they have bonfires anymore, but there's just chairs everywhere. It's meant to hold a lot of people. So it seemed like a great concept. But the problem is it's turned into such a frat party every time you go there that like people are out of control. Like people,
they serve drinks in plastic bags.
They serve drinks in plastic bags like you're in Daytona Beach. It's like doesn't fit in with the neighborhood. And so it attracts a much younger crowd that's in college, and they're just like, I mean, they serve people to the point where people are passing out. And it just, to me, it doesn't do the neighborhood any positivity to have it because it's really dangerous. Like we've seen a lot of people leave Lady Bird and like get on Bird scooters, crash, break their face open.
Yep.
I mean, we've had a guy fall asleep on our front doorstep. Guarantee he came from Lady Bird.
Yeah,
I mean,
he had a plastic bag on.
It's the only place that like truly overserves people and doesn't really care. And then they have like insanely, I mean, the loud music doesn't bother me as much because it's, I mean, we're in a city, but
bothers our neighbors.
It bothers our neighbors. It is really loud. It's
yeah.
Really, really, really loud. And they basically are like cutting it as close to the noise ordinance as possible. And they're just really disrespectful to the neighborhood, in my opinion.
Our neighbors measure decibels on their phones so they can call the police on this place.
Yeah, they've called the police like I don't even know how many times. Which
I just don't like them because they don't care about being part of the neighborhood.
Exactly.
They don't care about locals. They're catering to that.
They're just element. Focused on taking advantage of tourists and over-serving young kids.
So this episode brought to you by Lady Bird.
Yeah, I mean that's the only one. Like that's the only one we're negative about that we're down on.
Yeah.
You
wanted to talk about, in the last few episodes, but I haven't let you, you want to talk about this book spree that you're on.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I kind of feel like I'm really late to the party, but the Kristen Hanna books have just like grabbed me and won't let me go. And I've read, so far, I've read the Nightingale, which is like her number one. But like everyone that's read anything of hers has probably read that. The Women and...
The Women.
Yeah, The Women.
It's creative.
Oh my gosh, what was the other? Oh, and The Great Alone. So The Great Alone. So I read Nightingale, The Great Alone, and The Women. I only have like an hour left of The Women, which is all about Vietnam. And then the next one I think I'm gonna read is Four Winds, I believe that it is. Like wind.
With a D.
Yeah, with a D. So yeah, I mean, it's just the way she writes it. It's really engaging. It's really good. And it gives you good perspective, because even though we all learned, I mean, most of them are about either World War II or Vietnam or just like times in America that I didn't grow up during that time, obviously.
And they're all from a female perspective, and they're
all
from
they're all telling the story from a female perspective, or really just not even a perspective, but like a female life and what they experienced during that time. And it's not, I hate saying it like that because people's minds now go to like, oh, it's some like feminist novel, whatever.
Yeah.
It's more, it's
but it doesn't feel like that at all.
No, it's just giving you a different perspective of war. And I think it's just really interesting. And it also, again, like I said, as kids, you know, you learn about all of these wars throughout grade school, but I wouldn't say there's like good story, or at least when I was in public school in Florida, which is not known for their, not known for their education system. Maybe if you went to like a really fancy private school, you had better education, but
I think so.
I did not. And so
shout out to Dr. Phillips.
Yeah. Yeah. You just didn't hear like these interesting stories. And a lot of her, or at least the Nightingale, is loosely based off of a real person or a real experience. So I think it's good. It's good perspective for nowadays when we think that, you know.
Well, I just like that it has fueled a fire for you to want to watch World War II movies and TV shows, which is one of my favorite genres. So we're watching Masters of the Air,
which is really good.
It stars Elvis Presley.
Austin Butler.
Oh, sorry. But he's still in Elvis. He's still in Elvis Presley. He is. Like, he's talking like he's Elvis the whole time.
Well, I read a thing that he said he can't get rid of it. Like, he was doing, maybe it was like method acting to get into the character of Elvis, and now he can't get rid of it. Like,
I believe it.
He can't get rid of the voice. But, I mean, if
it, I hear is Elvis every time he opens his mouth, and he's like in World War II flying a B-17.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's a pretty good show, though.
Also, don't let the opening credits like throw you off, because it's
very cheesy.
It's like a really cheesy opening, but I think they were trying to mirror it after like what a show would have looked like back during that time if they had the technology to make a show like that.
Yeah.
So yeah, don't let that throw you off, because it is a good story.
And it's got like major A-list actors. It's got your boy Barry.
Oh, Barry Keough?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's in it.
Yeah.
Yeah, and they're not afraid to like get rid of main characters, so it's really good.
Yeah, I mean, we haven't finished it or anything, but we're giving it a thumbs up. Sorry. Definitely. to distract you, but I just thought that World War II energy that you have right now is pretty exciting for me.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of like I love it, but it also kind of bums me out, because I wish I would have asked my granddad more questions about World War II.
Yeah,
because he flew. What was it, B-17s?
I think B-17s.
Yeah, like the Flying Fortress. He flew the Flying Fortress bombers, and so then like learning about all of this stuff that all these guys went through, I wish I would have asked. I didn't know at the time, because he was really old. He was a very old grandfather to me.
Yeah.
So, I just wish I would have asked more questions when I was younger.
First time I met him, he was in his 90s, and he still looked like a pilot in World War II.
He literally has his...
He had the aviators on.
Yeah.
And like the crisp shirt.
Last week would have been his 100th birthday.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Uh-huh. So, yeah, they had my dad, or adopted my dad, when they were in their 40s. So they were already, you know, pretty old. So then for me, I just have always had like these really older grandparents.
Yeah.
But yeah, he's an interesting guy. And I know my dad wrote like a whole kind of like memoir, or he like tried to write some sort of memoir. So I need to go back and read that. And
that'd be cool.
Yeah.
Could talk about that on the pod.
For sure. Yeah. I was actually trying to find it in my email. I need to text my dad about it, but.
I just know that he drank straight gin at 11 a.m.
Yes. But like not in an alcoholic way. Like I can never remember my granddad being drunk. He just like enjoyed a nice glass of straight gin at any time of the day.
As soon as he got there.
Yeah. Yeah. He was fun. But yeah, it's been really, I don't know.
Well, I think you're recommending it because you said it provides incredible perspective, like versus today versus then, what women went through during those times.
Well, and just like what everyone goes through, like, because I was thinking about, so we are working with a retired Navy SEAL Master Chief of Warfare. It's a really long title that I don't have memorized off the top of my head, but he's an incredibly impressive Navy SEAL, Edward Byers. You can Google him, look him up. He is a Medal of Honor recipient. So we've been working with him a lot for a client meeting, and the stories he tells us, it's just so interesting how he's kind of like, you know, America's at this point now where we have so much intel and so much technology. We address things before they ever happen. We have SEAL teams going in and they're taking care of situations so that we don't have to have a World War III, which back then, like, we didn't have that level of information and intel. So it turned into these massive wars.
Yeah.
And so I think I kind of feel like we just take that for granted nowadays.
Yeah.
And so reading all these books where you realize how bad, like, how everyone was in the war, you know, like, World War.
Yeah.
And nowadays we have a lot of amazing men and women serving and doing incredible things for us, but there's also so many men and women that we don't even know. They're behind the scenes just serving our country and really protecting us so that we can wake up every day and complain about the president.
Right.
You know,
Or go on long bike rides
or give our opinions about things we know nothing about. And so it's just interesting perspective, like reading about all of those, but then also having this really interesting person that we've been able to talk to a lot about his experiences in war nowadays.
Yeah. Yeah. It's been really interesting to hear from Ed and his perspective. I mean, I think what's interesting for a lot of these guys, especially once they retire, is to try and understand and get the perspective from the other side. And I think Ed's done a really good job mm-hmm. of that. But just knowing that no matter what we do, how many stories he tells us, we'll never really understand what it's like
out
there, you know, and it's crazy.
Yeah. Yeah. It's amazing. Like what men and women in our military can do and what they're trained it's mind-blowing when you hear, you know, the skill level and just like the mental capacity to take on all of these really difficult missions is crazy impressive. So anyways, I definitely recommend if you're looking for a good series of books, it's really, really good.
Yeah. What's her name again?
Kristen Hannah. Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, The Nightingale is definitely my favorite.
Okay, well, we've got a huge week on tap. We have multiple clients having multiple leadership meetings that we're involved in putting on. These are big, big events that are a culmination of months of work. And that's actually why we're working with Ed. And so we've got some big, big weeks ahead, and hopefully we'll have some good stuff to talk about
on definitely.
The next few pods.
Yeah. Yeah. We might have another solo episode coming up for next week. We're trying to line up some guests, but people's schedules now, you know, getting into spring and summer get a little difficult, but we do have some really exciting athletes that will be on the podcast over the next couple months. And we're going to try and get some more business people and different, you know, interesting guests.
Exactly. And thanks again to everyone that we've talked to over the last few weeks about the podcast, Yesterday's Ride. Again, multiple people said they listened to the podcast that we didn't even know. And we really thank all of our listeners out there for listening. Make sure you share and subscribe if you like us.
And give us a rating. Go on Apple or Spotify or whatever and rate us.
Rate us if you like us.
Yeah. If you don't, then don't rate us. No, we really appreciate it because this is hard to keep. It's not easy to keep doing this every week. But when we get the really positive feedback on the group rides or just like from clients or friends, it definitely motivates you to keep going. So we appreciate it.
For sure.
All right. Well, look out for new exciting stuff. We'll have more updates and we will talk to all of you soon.
All right. To be birds flying higher in a sky more blue. If I can dream of a better land where all my brothers walk hand in hand, tell me why. Sometime strong winds of promise that will blow away the doubt and fear. If I can dream
of a warmer sun, where hope keeps shining.